special after 40 years. What I'm going to do is very quickly introduce our four distinguished panelists, and I'm going to let them have edit because I know we have a lot to say over the next hour and a half. So, on the far right, we have Professor Robert Turner from the University of Virginia, and all of them have a very long and distinguished bio. So what I'm going to do is just tell you who they are and then let you look in the book for their bios. Then we have Professor Michael Newton from Vanderbilt. We have John Crook, who is currently a vice president of the American Society of International Law and has a distinguished years of service in the U.S. government. And we have Dr. Gregory Noone, who is a professor at Fairmont State University and a co-author of mine and a dear friend of mine, so I'm very happy to have you on the panel. They're each going to speak for about 12 or 13 minutes on a variety of topics. We're going to leave some extra time for questions. And, we know there's going to be a lot of questions, so we're going to build in extra time there. And I'll let you guys start. Professor Turner, I think you're going to go first. Thank you.
They told us 15 minutes.
You're following John.
Bob, you can have 5 of my minutes. Go ahead.
You're a gentleman scholar, the best traditions. But I will try not to take your time. I appreciate it. Let me start that. Here we go. First, I want to thank very much Mike Sharp for organizing this organization. He has been coming to the University of Virginia for the last, he's not old enough, but too many years, or so many years, to lecture in our National Security Law Institute. And when I heard he was having a program on war powers, a microphone, all right. Can you hear me? There we go. All right. Sorry, it's smaller than I am. There's got to be a fix for that. Anybody got a chainsaw? Right. Okay. Anyway, I have an awful lot of material. I've been working on these issues since 1973. I worked in the Senate during the first 5 years of the War Powers Resolution as National Security Advisor to a member of the Foreign Relations Committee. I was Acting Assistant Secretary of State for Congressional Relations, followed them there when I was in the White House. They sent me over to brief unknown members of Congress like Dan Quayle and Newt Gingrich, who were brand new then. Nobody had ever heard of them, and they went on to some shame or fame. I'll let you decide that. But anyway, and I've written a couple of books about it going back many years. That doesn't mean I've got the answers right, but let's start off with fundamental constitutional principles. The biggest misunderstanding about foreign affairs in the Constitution, and Harold Coe was credited with perpetrating it, is that the Constitution doesn't address this issue, and it's just like everything else. In fact, when the Founding Fathers gave the executive power to the President, they understood that term as it was used by Locke, Montesquieu, and Blackstone, as conveying with it the general control of what Locke called war, peace, leagues, and alliances to the executive, subject to very specific negatives or checks vested in the Senate or in Congress, such as the power of the Senate to confirm ambassadors, the power of 1/3 plus 1 of the Senate to defeat a treaty, the power of Congress to declare war, congressional control over the purse, and so forth. Thomas Jefferson, as our first Secretary of State and a member of Washington, noted, the Constitution has given executive power to the President, submitting special articles to a negative by the Senate. And he went on to say the transaction of business with foreign nations is executive altogether, and thus belongs to the head of that department. Exceptions are to be construed strictly, that is to say, as an exception to the executive power grant, this power to declare war and all of these other powers are to be construed strictly. 3 days later, Washington wrote in his diary that he had discussed Jefferson's memo with Madison and Chief Justice John Jay, who didn't know he wasn't supposed to give advisory opinions, and they shared Jefferson's view that the Senate had no constitutional right to interfere, all the rest being executive and vested in the President by the Constitution. Where in the Constitution? Article 2, Section 1. 3 years later, Jefferson's chief rival in Washington's cabinet wrote in his first Pacificus essay, the general doctrine of our Constitution is that the executive power is vested in the President, submitting only certain exceptions to the Congress. And he goes on to say, it deserves to be remarked that as the participation of the Senate in the making of treaties and the power of the legislature to declare war are exceptions out of the general, quote, executive power vested in the President, they are to be construed strictly and ought to be extended no further than is essential to their execution. In Marbury versus Madison, perhaps the most famous Supreme Court of all times, Chief Justice John Marshall noted that under the Constitution, the president was invested with certain important political powers. In the exercise, he was to use his own discretion. He said, the subjects are political, respecting the nation, not individual rights, and being entrusted to the executive, the decision of the executive is conclusive. And as an example of this, he pointed out the Department of Foreign Affairs. And he said, this officer was to carry out the will of the president. Very much of a unitary executive argument. The Secretary of State has no power other than that delegated to him by the president. Why? Because Article 2, Section 1, unlike Article 1 and Article 3, which grant power in the legislative branch and the judiciary, Article 2, Section 1 says the executive power of the nation shall be vested in a president, one person, and all executive power belongs there, and every executive officer acts pursuant to a delegation of authority from the president. I first got interested in these issues in 1966 when I heard a talk by the late Quincy Wright, who was one of the leading authorities in this field. His 1922 book, The Control of American Foreign Relations, may still be the best single volume on the subject. And he noted that when the convention gave executive power to the president, the foreign relations power was the essential element in the grant. My old friend Lou Hinken, who passed away a few years ago, noted in his book, Foreign Affairs and the Constitution in 1972, the executive power was not defined because it was well understood by framers raised on Locke, Montesquieu, and Blackstone, all of which argued that the foreign affairs power was vested in the executive. As recently as 1959, Foreign Relations Committee Chairman J. William Fulbright noted in a speech at Cornell Law School, the preeminent responsibility of the president for the formulation and conduct of American foreign policy is clear and unalterable. Now note he says the formulation and conduct. Some say, oh yes, he's the sole organ for communications, but Congress tells him, or the Senate tells him what to communicate. That was not the original understanding of the Constitution. I wrote a 1,700-page doctoral dissertation on this issue, and I went back and looked through all the early debates. It took me 300 pages just to get up to Philadelphia. And this case is very clear. I went back and said, what did the Founding Fathers read? What did these people say about foreign affairs, separation of powers, declarations of war? And it is absolutely clear. In the Constitutional Convention, the original draft they were working from gave Congress the power to make war. And on August 17th, Madison proposed an amendment, striking make war and giving Congress instead the more limited power to declare war, leaving the president the power to act defensively. When Rufus King noted that make war might include conducting it, which was an executive function, only a single state opposed the amendment and it was passed. Since 1801, American presidents have sent military forces into harm's way, often into serious hostilities, more than 200 times, and Congress has seldom complained until the post-Vietnam era. Jefferson sent two-thirds of the American Navy halfway around the known world with instructions that if they learned upon arriving at Gibraltar that any of the Barbary pirates had declared war against us, it took 6 weeks to get a message back and forth by ship, they were to so dispose of the forces assigned to them as to chastise their insolence, protect our commerce, and sink and burn their ships wherever you can find them. He did not tell Congress until his first message to Congress in 1801. In December 8th of 1801. The Supreme Court has noted that the presidents have used armed forces outside this country more than 200 times for the protection of Americans. The scholarly debate is too often focused on what is war. The power given Congress was not the power of war, but the power to declare war. That was a term of art from the Law of Nations. It was well understood by the framers. They were very well-read men, incredibly so. They had read Hugo Grotius. They had read Vattel. They understood also that declare war was an exception to the general executive power. I would argue the power to declare war is an anachronism. Gentile told us in 1620 that when war is undertaken for the purpose of defense, the declaration is not at all required. Grotius said no declaration is required when one is repelling an invasion or seeking to punish the actual author of some crime. The Congress is given the power to declare war and grant letters of marque and reprisal in Clause 11 of Article 1, Section 8. Both are anachronisms. Letters of marque were outlawed in 1856 in the Declaration of Paris. and the type of war associated with formal declarations, where I'm going to skip that, were outlawed in, certainly first in the Kellogg-Briand Treaty in 1928, but then in the UN Charter. No country has formally declared war since 1945. This doesn't mean Congress has no role in war. The Commander-in-Chief power is a hollow power. The President has no military to command unless Congress first raises and supports an army and provides and maintains a navy. He has no money without appropriations made by law. But those powers do not involve controlling force short of war, or we can talk about this in Q&A. Congress does not have the right to put any rider it wants on an appropriations bill and tell the President how to fight a war. And if they can do that, I'll tell you something, we have no separation of powers, because there's no reason they can't pass a law saying no money shall be available for the Supreme Court if they overturn any act of Congress. It's what I call the Supreme Court Neutralization Act of 2013. The court hasn't got a prayer if they can take away the enumerated commander-in-chief power from the President. So anyway, as I mentioned, I've written a couple of books on this, one going back to 1983 with a foreword by John Tower. We have a Texas representative or somewhere, the distinguished chairman of the Senate for Armed Services Committee, the other by Gerald Ford, the former president of the United States. Quickly on UN Security Council authorization. Overwhelmingly, those who in the Senate who approved the UN, who consented to the ratification of the UN Charter, and those in the House who approved the UN Participation Act, said the President has the power under the Constitution to carry out our obligations under the Charter. The Foreign Relations Committee chairman said that action by U.S. forces on the order of the Security Council would not be an act of war and thus did not affect the exclusive power of Congress to declare war. This is from the unanimous report of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. And they went on to say that a reservation by Congress would violate the spirit of the Constitution under which the President has well-established powers and obligations to use our armed forces without specific approval of Congress. House Foreign Affairs Committee quoted that language unanimously and went on to say the basic decision of the Senate in advising and consenting to ratification of the Charter created obligations which will actually be carried out by and under the authority of the President. The ratification of the Charter resulted in the vesting in the executive branch of the power and obligation to fulfill the commitments assumed by the United States under the UN Charter. Oh, wow, I'm really running out of time fast. Senator Burton Wheeler introduced an amendment that would require congressional authorization to use force pursuant to a Chapter 7 decision. He was defeated. It received fewer than 10 votes in the Senate, overwhelmingly. All right, real quick, war powers, we're going to skip that. Just because of time, there is a paper back there somewhere. Let's see, talk about Vietnam. Basically, Vietnam was not a presidential war. Neither was Korea, by the way. In Korea, top secret documents now released show, as soon as Truman came back to Washington, he said, "I want to go to a joint session of Congress. Acheson, draft an AUMF." He didn't call it that, but he asked a session. He met with congressional leaders and they said, stay away from Congress. And he finally said, well, I just didn't want to be seen as doing anything extra constitutional. If you guys don't think I should do it, I won't push it. And then the Republicans nailed him and said, oh, he violated the Constitution and so forth. In Vietnam, Congress passed a statute authorizing the war by a 99.6% majority. You can round up that up if you'd like. But the idea that Congress played no role in Vietnam is a myth. It was a lie, and the War Powers Resolution was a fraud enacted to convince the American people that Congress wasn't responsible. Now, very quickly, I want to just make my last comments here, and that is the harm done by the War Powers Resolution. There was a very partisan debate on the deployment in Lebanon. The ROE, the Rules of Engagement in Lebanon, where you can only fire when you're fired upon, pure self-defense. This is not a situation for a declaration of war. The Washington Post noted how partisan the Democrats were. Two Democrats supported President Reagan, and the end result was we sent a signal to the terrorists that if you kill some Marines, they will leave. Right after that, we actually intercepted a message between the terrorists, and it said if we kill 15 Marines, the rest will leave. They killed 241 Marines. Osama bin Laden in 1998 told an ABC News reporter that the Beirut bug out showed him Americans cannot take casualties, and that's why he attacked us, killing almost 3,000 Americans on 9/11. And if you want to go further about congressional law breaking in the post-Vietnam era, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act is flagrantly unconstitutional. We can go into that in Q&A if you want. That statute kept our intelligence community from stopping the 9/11 attacks. There is absolutely no question about it in my mind. The FBI spotted two of the guys on the plane that hit the Pentagon months earlier, and they were told to back off because they couldn't tie him to a foreign power. And Congress, by statute, had said you cannot electronically surveil any foreign person in this country unless you can prove there or tie them to a foreign power like Al-Qaeda. So bottom line, unconstitutional, unnecessary, fraud on the people. It helped provoke 9/11 attacks, and another unconstitutional statute in the post-Vietnam era kept us from stopping those attacks. Thank you. Sorry that went on. Actually, I'm only 34 seconds after the time. No, I've got 32 seconds left of my 15 minutes. Anyway, thank you. We'll talk later.
Next is John Crook.
Well, thank you, Bob, for those remarks, and thanks to Michael and everyone else for organizing this program. I'm a little bit of an imposter. I'm not a national security scholar. I'm a pensioner. I was a State Department lawyer for 30 years, and since then I've primarily spent my time doing some arbitration and writing lots of stuff that nobody reads. I think I'm primarily here because I once gave Michael Sharf a good review for a book, and this this may be my payoff. I'm going to try to do three things. First of all, I want to give you a little bit of a quick and dirty on what the War Powers Resolution is, to give you some context for what it is we're actually talking about here, and what it is that Bob just denounced in such authoritative terms. Then I will do a real blitzkrieg through, let me do the math, almost 40 years of history of what's happened under the War Powers Resolution. And I will advocate in general terms the proposition that the resolution hasn't amounted to much, that it has been the occasion for a lot of political controversy, a lot of political debate, but I think it has very minimal influence on actual decisions to deploy force by American presidents. And I will conclude with some suggestions as to why I think the resolution is even less likely to be significant in the future. Now, what are we talking about? What is this War Powers Resolution? Section 2. It is the purpose of this joint resolution to fulfill the intent of the framers of the Constitution of the United States to ensure that the collective judgment of both the Congress and the President will apply to the introduction of U.S. armed forces into hostilities. How is that to come about? Section 3, consultation. The President in every possible instance shall consult before he does it. Section 4, whenever he does it, that is, introduce U.S. forces into hostilities or situations where they are imminent, he shall within 48 hours submit a report of a specified character indicating what he's doing and why he's doing it. Then we get to the real teeth of the thing, Section 5B. Within 60 days after such a report is submitted or required to be submitted, the President shall terminate any use of U.S. armed forces with respect to which the report was submitted or should have been submitted unless Congress has declared war or enacted a specific authorization for such use of U.S. armed forces or has extended the 60-day period. So Congress basically said, Mr. President, in the circumstance of introduction into hostilities or imminent hostilities, you shall report in a specified way, and unless we agree with you in the form of a declaration of war or in the form of a resolution of approval, you pull the forces out. That's what we're talking about. Now, time is tight. As I look at the audience, I see there's a number of folks out there who, with me, probably can remember those halcyon years of 1972, 1973 that led to the adoption of the resolution. I was then a brand-new second lieutenant in the military police, seeing the aftermath of the Vietnam War on the U.S. Army, so I had a certain personal interest in the resolution. I was led to believe that one or another of these guys, that either Greg or Mike, was going to talk something about the political circumstances of adoption. Great. Then I won't say anything further, except to conclude rather in broad terms that it was the product of a particularly contentious time, at a time in which we had a particularly weakened president and a particularly feisty Congress. Now, the overall view, has the thing worked? Well, I think it's important to note that since 1973, no administration has accepted the constitutionality of the resolution. But I think it's also important to note that at the other end of Pennsylvania Avenue, Congress, with perhaps the one exception that Bob described, has not mustered the collective will to insist upon the role it defined for itself in Article 5. Now, from time to time, the resolution has offered the opportunity for some lively debate in Congress. I think a lot of this has been driven more by partisanship than by authentic concerns about the respective allocations of executive and congressional authority. And I think in that respect, Jeremy Rabkin is right, that there are a lot of these debates have been about politics. But it is the case that there have been lots of instances where U.S. forces have been introduced into circumstances of potential peril. There have been at least 134, maybe it's now up to 135, war power reports where presidents have reported the presence of U.S. troops in unpleasant places in a manner consistent with the war powers resolution. Those are the talismanic words. These reports always say consistent with. The only instance where Congress has adopted a Section 5 resolution is the situation that Bob alluded to. That's not entirely true. I'll come to three other cases in a minute, but up until more recent years, the only instance was the Section 5 resolution relating to Lebanon. Well, what has Congress done in relation to these things? Well, there's certainly been occasions for great debate. There have been occasions when there wasn't great debate. There have been a couple of instances where presidents have, more than a couple, there have been instances where presidents have deployed U.S. forces under circumstances arguably implicating the resolution, where there's been remarkably little congressional response. Did I hear a dissent?
No, Panama is a good example.
Well, exactly. Panama, 1989. We invaded Panama. We deposed. He wasn't the head of government. We deposed a prominent figure. And so far as I can ascertain, Congress basically stood up and cheered. The same in 1983 in Grenada, shortly after the tragic Beirut bombing. But again, although forces stayed on that little island longer than 60 days, Congress again basically stood up and cheered. The determination of what Congress does in a particular instance is very often covered by a political dynamic, not by legal assessment. Now, there have been times when there has been intense congressional debate about particular actions. There, again, with the exception of Lebanon, Congress typically has failed to take authoritative action. President Clinton's participation in the Kosovo bombing campaign, a case that many would argue clearly implicated the resolution. The House was unable to take decisive action. I have here someplace a wonderful quote from Clinton's spokesman after the floor action in the House, in which he concluded that, quote, the House today voted no on going forward, no on going back, and they tied on standing still. But you saw pretty much the same thing following the in the aftermath of the debate about U.S. forces involvement in the action against Libya. There, the House voted down a resolution to endorse the action, and they voted down a resolution to cut off funding for its continuation. Congress has not been able, as an institution, to perform the role it set for itself in the War Powers Resolution. And I would assert that the resolution has simply not had a great deal, has not had effect on decisions to deploy force, except at the margins. Now, there have been three instances where presidents have gone to Congress and says, please bless this use of force. My time is short. I'll just rattle them off quickly. The first Gulf War, the first President Bush, just on the eve of the invasion, of the attack, did get seek and obtain congressional authorization, although he did subsequently observe that he didn't need the approval of some old goat in Congress to kick Saddam Hussein out of Kuwait, which I think, Professor Sadat, you wrote on that at one point, as I recall. Second case, fall of 2002, the Iraq invasion. The president went to and Congress approved specific authorization. Third case, September 2001, when Congress adopted the mother of all Section 5 authorizations, the Authorization of Military Force Act, for the use of Military Force Act, which Professor Goldsmith talked about, and which in the intervening 11 years has provided statutory cover for an enormous range of uses of U.S. force in lots of places. I invite you to take a look at the latest War Powers report. I think the last one I saw was June 15th. White House puts them up. You can read them. And you will find there a long list of places where U.S. forces are deployed being reported for purposes consistent with the War Powers Act. Okay, so I would hypothesize the act hasn't worked. It hasn't made much of a difference. And I would hypothesize further that it's going to make less of a difference in the future. Now, Yogi Berra, correct on this, as on many things, said the trouble with predicting the future is we don't know what's going to happen. and he's right, but I think I'm fairly safe in what I'm going to say. I think the War Powers Resolution is going to have even less effect in the future for a number of reasons. One is the Authorization for the Use of Military Force Act, in which Congress granted very broad authorization to the president to use force for a range of purposes without geographic limitation, without limitation as to the type of forces involved. Professor Goldsmith this morning ruminated, I think, in a very interesting way about what the son or daughter of the AUMF is going to look like. I'm with Yogi on that one. I don't know what's going to happen. But certainly for a number of years and for, I think, some time into the future, the AMUF is going to moot the War Powers Resolution for a lot of purposes because there's going to be a lot of presidential uses of U.S. forces that are going to fall under the rubric of the act. Second reason, there have been some profound changes in the way the United States uses force. I'm going to run out of time, so I'm going to have to short circuit here. But, you know, who runs the, I won't call them drones, I'll call them remotely piloted vehicles that are striking people in Pakistan? It's not people wearing uniforms. It's people who don't wear uniforms. And that's true around the globe, that the United States is increasingly using other kinds of assets for purposes of inflicting force. And that activity doesn't fall under the War Powers Act resolution, which is framed in terms of introduction of U.S. forces. And that's a statutory term for people who wear uniforms. Similarly, the way that war is waged is being dramatically changed. Instead of people being physically put into situations of danger, you know, RPVs are being driven by Air Force colonels sitting on National Guard bases in upstate New York. The paradigm that drove the War Powers Resolution, the notion of people being physically involved in combat, doesn't make sense anymore. This was part of the Professor Coe's, or legal advisor Coe's, defense of the action in Libya. And you know, whether you buy that or not, it is certainly the case that the way the United States applies force today is dramatically different from the way it was applied in 1993. The forces of repression are shutting me down. I think there are other reasons that I think one could point to. I've written a paper where they're spelled out in little greater detail, and if you're interested, I invite you to take a look at the paper.
Thank you very much. Mike?
Well, thank you. Let me echo my appreciation to Michael Scharf. This is just a fantastic event, and in particular, also my deep respect for my co-panelists. What a great group. It's just a joy to be here. Bob, in his typically nuanced, sort of subtle fashion, used the term fraud. I would approach some of the same sentiments with the term feckless. You know, in essence, the 40 plus year history, we're pretty close. October 1973 was when the veto was overridden.
November.
November 17th. But the idea that we have a statutory straitjacket on executive authority is not only misplaced, but has been demonstrated by consistent practice. And there was a little bit of discussion earlier this morning about Dellums v. Bush, the Kosovo case. I confess I was on the ground in Kosovo. You know, there's no standing there. There's no constitutional impasse, no squarely issue presented, no standing. Dellums v. Bush was the ripeness case. The NATO bombing campaign was a standing case. So members of Congress, 54 ago, the idea that there's the binding statutory constraint on executive power is simply misplaced. So what I want to do in an altogether inadequate amount of time, and all of us will write and have written essays, so this will all be in print in much greater detail, is to go back and reassess. I think the impulse of the War Powers Resolution itself was appropriate, but it really is time to reassess, in light of modern warfare, in light of modern technology, its implementation. And you know, in our political debate these days, we toss around the concept of repeal and replace. I'd like to propose, in the end, a little bit of I think fairly controversial ways of rethinking repealing and replacing. But in particular, I want to focus the most of my time on what the name of my paper is: Inadvertent Implications of the War Powers Resolution. I don't think it's appropriate for us today, in light of what we know now of the way this has been implemented and what we know now in practice, to say, well, it's cabined, and therefore it really has no effect. It has profound effects, and I would argue some profoundly dangerous effects, and I'll point to three specific ways. With all due respect to Bob, and I'm a little hesitant here because I suspect he's probably gone back and read the handwritten copies of these notes, but I think it's important to back up just a little bit to the time of the framers and to really focus on what was going on. We forget that there was big debates in the Constitutional Convention about whether we should have a plurality of executives. This idea of entrusting executive power to one individual was very controversial. And of course, this is in light of our historical experience coming out of the monarchy, especially when you paired that with the idea of a standing army. You put those two things together, and this concept of the proper bounds of executive authority and the proper structure of our republic was very controversial. This, of course, must have been very difficult for George Washington to hear as he sat there and listened to this. From the draft, not the real inaugural, but the draft of his first inaugural address, there's evidence that he was still very conscious of this, what it meant in terms of his authority. Let me read to you what he said. If there should be a single citizen of the United States to whom the tenor of my life is so little known that he could imagine me capable of being so smitten with the allurements of sensual gratification, the frivolities of ceremony, the baubles of ambition, as to be induced from such motives to accept public appointment, I shall only lament his imperfect acquaintance with my heart and leave him until another retirement shall work conviction. Now, why is this relevant? Because in the Constitutional Convention, the key constraint on executive authority is exactly what we've seen demonstrated over and over and over again, what Bob so persuasively writes about in the context of the Korean War, which is the funding constraint. Every single objection that was raised to the concept of a standing army was rebutted by saying, oh, Congress has the power to fund and equip that army. And it was because of that compromise, and this is important, Bob pointed out that the framers rejected this concept that Congress could make war. That's very clear. Congress declares war. Washington spent the entire revolution begging Congress and fighting with them about the conduct of the hostilities. That's very clear. But what they also rejected was this concept that Congress had a role in ending conflict. The original phrase was make or declare war and peace. And they said, no, the idea is we want to empower the executive to conduct foreign affairs, the executive power, in the way that best serves American interests. Now, that's very important because, to go back to, as John said, the context of the War Powers Resolution itself. In a way, it's the most notable, visible landmark because we have 130-plus now declarations consistent with. It's the most notable benchmark of this tension between the legislative and the executive branch. I would argue that in some ways, it's an accident of the time. October 1973, which is why I got focused on October, the Yom Kippur War kicks off. People forget that President Truman had engaged with Congress early on, essentially seeking an a priori authorization for use of American force in the Middle East. You don't think when Yom Kippur kicks off, there's a few legislators that remember that dialogue and that debate? President Nixon had 8 successful vetoes in a row, and it was finally time, because of the politics of the day, to override a veto. John mentioned, of course, the weakened presidency in the light of Watergate. The Saturday Night Massacre had just happened. 14 days prior to the override, the Vice President of the United States had resigned, and it's time for a resurgent Congress to attempt to draw some statutory bounds. This is framed as the most visible landmark in terms of the congressional executive debate, but I would also argue that in some sense, this was an epical time in terms of the way we conduct conflict. Remember, this was the time period where we shifted to a volunteer force. This was the time period in the beginning in the post-Vietnam era where we really did rebuild an effective, functional U.S. military force. This was a profound time in American civic life. Having said all that, I think it's a grave mistake to look at the War Powers Resolution as a zero-sum game. I think it was a great mistake to frame executive power and the conduct of armed conflict, which today, as has been pointed out, has such a broad array of meanings. We deploy U.S. forces in so many other ways than just what the framers would have conceived of as making war. I want to point out 3 key ways why I think the War Powers Resolution is not feckless in the way that we think of legally. It is legally feckless, but operationally, practically, has had 3 very key, and I would argue, very detrimental effects. The first is that it displaced attention from the role of the president to lead and not to litigate. Presidents, every single president of all parties in all circumstances, have done what they thought was best to serve American interests. I accept that premise. When advisors have then said, but this War Powers thing, there's a consistent developed state practice of the declarations and a long line of OLC opinions that say, no problem, I can win that in the courts, I can win that vis-a-vis Congress, and a long line of what some scholars call congressional acquiescence in the funding process, meaning that a succession, a bipartisan succession of Congresses have essentially forfeited their real constitutional power, which is the power of the budget. And some people have said, well, that means that the president has eroded the power of Congress. No, I think Congress has abandoned that over and over and over and over and over again. But what it's done is it has short-circuited the need of the president not to speak to Congress, not to deal with Congress, but to deal directly to the American people. That is the president's job, particularly in a volunteer force, to persuade the American people of the tight connection between the U.S. national strategic objective and the conduct of the operation. Congress, in a sense, is the representative of the American people. But we know they are not the American people. I think the effect of the War Powers Resolution has been to detract from that. The second thing is, and this is very clear from the history and from the debates, Bob referenced the Osama bin Laden declaration. It has focused the attention of our enemies on the Achilles heel of American foreign policy, which is exactly our lack of political will. Let me read to you testimony from Secretary Shultz barely a month before the Marine Beirut bombing. He says, it's not the mission of our Marines as a whole to maintain the military balance by themselves. Their presence remains one crucial pillar To remove the Marines would put both the government and what we're trying to achieve in jeopardy. This is why our domestic controversy over war powers has been so disturbing. Uncertainty about the American commitment can only weaken our effectiveness. Doubts about our staying power can only cause potential aggressors to discount our presence and intensify their attacks in the hopes of hastening our departure. Isn't that sad? When you know what happened in history, that's exactly what happened. Lance Corporal Eddie DeFranco had clear rules of engagement as he stood there that his weapon couldn't be loaded. The driver of the yellow Mercedes drove by, smiled at him as he drove, and the sergeant of the guard recounts the same thing. The sergeant of the guard only had one sidearm, a pistol, as a truck bomb killed 241 American service members. I think that's tragic, and we've seen over and over and over again in later history that the focus on American political will, and I think the War Powers Act has done that. We've said, well, as long as I make a declaration consistent with, I really don't need to keep engaging the American people, whether it's Afghanistan, whether it's a continuing conflict in Iraq, whether it's the drone policy, et cetera. I think that's false. I think it's dangerous. And lastly, without being political here, I think I'm very troubled personally by the idea that we can reverse engineer operations. I think it's the president's job, it's the job of national security policymakers to have a very tight nexus, a very tight connection between U.S. strategic policies, the rules of engagement that are designed in the field to implement those policies and actually achieve American strategic objectives. The idea that we can reverse engineer actual operations in a way that now we can say with a straight face, oh yes, we've complied. If you read the legal opinions, of course, from Kosovo, this is, from Libya, this is blindingly obvious. Our entire legal rationale rests upon the idea that we're not conducting hostilities. It's very technical, it's very legalistic, and from that flows rules of engagement on the ground, and a hypersensitivity to casualties, and a hypersensitivity to the way we conduct operations. This is backwards from the way it is supposed to be done in our constitutional structure. The Commander-in-Chief says, this is the overriding national security objective. I, as the Commander-in-Chief, authorize this and order it, and therefore we have a tight nexus. Tragically, going back to Lebanon, there was a cartoon on the bulletin board, and here's what it said. A Marine rifleman is in a prone position. This is the picture behind a barricade. The President of the United States whispers in the air, before you fire, I want you to consider the nuances of the War Powers Resolution. That to me is tragic. Tragic. And so I think this is one of the very subtle, very dangerous effects of this resolution in practice. It's not that it may be feckless legally, but operationally and in reality, it has a very detrimental effect that we need to address pointedly, both in our planning and our conduct of operations. Quickly, because I know I'm running out of time, let me just sort of sit back and try to be professorial, and we can swirl our cognac together and try to think about what it would look like if we actually repealed and replaced this thing with something that really did work, right? So one option might be to do exactly what the House of Representatives attempted to do in the early drafts of the resolution. This did not become law. It was quickly overcome by debates. But I would argue, they're telling me to stop. Give me one more minute. I would argue that this is the most appropriate, actually I should ask, I asked my good
the
friend.
The gentleman from West Virginia yields his time. Too.
Thank you, sir. 1 minute. 1 minute for three ideas. Click. Starting now. One is, you know, the original House version had a very clear limit. It was not a blank check. It said, when the president initiates military activities, he may do so on his discretion, his commander-in-chief's authority, up to such and such funding level. Now, that's right squarely in accord with the framers' intent and the Constitution. And therefore, what it sets up is the kind of discussion that I've talked about. I'm going to spend more money, Congress, and more importantly, in my view, American people. And here's why. Here's the strategic objectives. It clearly frames that conversation on the most strong and clear and appropriate congressional authority, which is the power of the purse. That was rejected. I think it's time to bring it back. Secondly, I would favor a statutory set of confidential briefings. You know, we do this in the covert action realm. I think it's time to do it in the operational realm. Nobody, including me, questions the authority of the Commander-in-Chief to have rules of engagement and commander's guidance. I don't necessarily want Al-Qaeda or the Taliban or al-Shabaab, to know exactly. So let's do those, that tight nexus, that discussion in a confidential way, behind closed doors. Let's have some real hard, good, honest discussions about that. And lastly, I would require, statutorily, comments by the President, not to the Congress, but to the American people, something akin to the State of the Union, to have that discussion in a more public way, because I think that's what's going on, particularly in an all-volunteer force. The executive, in my view, cannot outsource executive authority. It's one thing to send Harold Coe out to explain this. It's another thing to send Brennan out to explain this. And I think that's a positive thing, but it doesn't substitute for the voice of the commander-in-chief, the chief executive, in whose constitutional authority the executive power is wielded. I think that when we conduct military operations, the American people are willing to sustain the casualties that are concomitant to the pursuit of articulated U.S. strategic interests. And it's the President's job to articulate those interests in a way that resonates with the American people. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mike. Greg?
Great, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. Michael, thank you to you and Trina, as always, for being such gracious hosts. Thank you to the rest of the Case Western staff and students, from Tim to Nancy and Alice and Brittany and Jessica and the rest of you that do such a great job running these events. It really is an honor to be on this panel. When Michael sent me that I was on this panel, I my first question was, why me? Because these gentlemen obviously do such a wonderful job in this area. So I'm going to just try to round up a few little bits here and then get to questions as fast as we can, so we can ask people like Bob Turner why it's a fraud and examine more why some of the things John and Michael have said. I haven't read Jack Goldsmith's book yet. I really look forward to it. And I'm sure you're probably paraphrasing and shorthanding it, but one of the things that Jack said this morning was, when President Bush did soft things like Gitmo releases or trying people in civilian courts, Democrats like the policy, the Republicans like the President. And then he said, when Obama does hard things like drones, Republicans like the policy and Democrats like the President. So there's an element of partisanship to that. When it's your guy, you're going to support it. Maybe you don't really like it. And of course, there's always outliers. There's always I'm in Ohio, so there's always the Dennis Kuciniches. So there's always the outliers. No offense to Dennis Kucinich, but there's always guys like him on both ends that are going to jump up and down. And in case of Mr. Kuciniches, he has to jump really high. But playing against type, where President Obama is doing drones or that maybe President Bush is authorizing releases, has long has a history in American politics. It takes an anti-communist like Nixon to go to China. It takes a Democrat like Bill Clinton to reform welfare. Think about George W. Bush's signature domestic policy, No Child Left Behind. That's something that he can grab as a Republican and kind of run with it to play against type. But in my research, what we found is that doesn't always hold true when presidents use force. That clearly falls under the rubric of the War Powers Resolution. So we looked at the partisanship angle and essentially tried to figure out, is it we support it when it's our guy, we don't support it when it's our guy? So in looking at the votes over the years, you'd think that the votes would pretty much run along party lines. But they don't. What we found instead was that it wasn't so much partisanship, but what the Gallup polling said the American people thought. And I have to tell you, this is, you know, the wrap-up of both the conventions, one of my favorite convention stories of all time as a political scientist. And I have to say that because my mother always wanted me to be a scientist. One of my favorite stories comes from the 1964 Democratic National Convention, when a woman across the aisle from Texas was talking to a gentleman from, over here from Illinois, and they were talking about how we think we're going to win, and the woman from Texas says, but I don't know, I don't trust the polls. And the guy from Illinois says, no, the polls are good people. So. But going back to the point here, Congress's action is much more closely linked to public opinion. This, of course, doesn't surprise anyone who follows politics, but we are talking about sending men and women to harm's way and possibly to their death. So you would think that we would have leaders and less followers who stick their fingers in the air. Frankly, Congress is happy. So the comment that Michael made about feckless, I think it's purposeful fecklessness. The Congress is quite happy to let the president take the heat on this. We know through history, over time, U.S. engagements overseas lose popular opinion over at home. Now, it's just a matter of how quickly they lose it, how long they can sustain it, et cetera, et cetera. So the Congress is happy to sit back and let the president pay any price at the polls that may be paid. Opposing the use of force in Congress is no less domestically risky than it was before the War Powers Resolution. In other words, there are, as we say in political science, electoral disincentives for confronting the president on foreign policy, particularly if a congressman is going to try to constrain the president by cutting off funding. Allegations of being unpatriotic, allegations of abandoning the U.S. forces in the field, those will be quickly leveled, and it will hurt that particular congressman's reelection bid. In fact, the votes on funding are almost overwhelmingly approved and very decisive. However, when public opinion declines, Congress is more likely to assert itself that by maintaining the president is violating the law, if in fact it fits under the War Powers Resolution, if it's applicable, then they are to pull funding. So they're more likely to assert that the law is being violated, and they use that kind of we're rule of law, we live in a democracy, as a shield against any charges of being unpatriotic, because that's the simple charge against someone who wants to take action using the money. As we've noted, no president has accepted the constitutionality of the War Powers Act. With that said, research indicates that the presidents have appeared to have been impacted, and their behavior has been impacted by this. Presidents have rarely used force for more than 60 days without congressional authorization. An examination of conflicts where troops, where there were greater than 500 U.S. troops, authors Ereswald and Kohi discussed three periods of similar duration. 1900 to 1925, there are five major conflicts that are undertaken without congressional approval. Fighting and subsequent occupation lasted anywhere from 2 to 19 years. In the period 1947 to 1972, there are 8 uses of force without prior congressional approval, and that period runs from about 2.5 months to 7 years. And the president's use of force is never challenged in any of those scenarios. From 1973, after the War Powers Resolution, as Michael and others have correctly stated, you know, this is also after Vietnam and you know, Watergate and a whole bunch of other things, there are 14 conflicts without prior congressional approval, but 10 of which were less than the 60 days. The four resulted in congressional action, and they're Lebanon, Somalia, the Persian Gulf reflagging, which as a Navy guy, I have to bring up reflagging, and then, of course, Desert Shield, not Desert Storm, but Desert Shield. So in conclusion, to give us more time for questions, we know presidents rarely consult Congress before using the use of force. However, it appears that presidents have been impacted by the War Powers Resolution, and Congress is perfectly happy to let the president do what he's doing until the polls start to turn, and then Congress starts exerting itself and saying, now wait a minute, you did not follow the rules on this one. So with that said, I'll very briefly turn it over. Again, thank you to Michael and everyone here, and I hopefully left enough questions for all of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for four great presentations. We're going to take questions now. I'd ask that you speak into the microphone, and I know some of the folks in the overflow room are having a little trouble hearing the feed from these microphones, so if I can, I will just give a quick summary of the question afterwards, since this mic seems to be sending the sound in there better. So go ahead.
Hi. Hello, overflow room. Ben Davis from Toledo. Question I have is, we've talked a lot about the War Powers Resolution and sort of this process between the sitting president and the Congress, but I wanted to ask about something related to the executive power of the presidency, which is, what about once a president has left office, a former president, and we find out that what he did in office was lawless? In that setting, is it possible for a prosecution of such a person to happen? To take an example, if I go with Mr. Turner's view of executive power, what if a president started a war to please his girlfriend or boyfriend? Is that within the executive power of the president to do?
What
or is there a limit? Is there a limit in the Constitution on the president's power to do it? Because the president does not have the immunity that congressional people have. So the question is, if a president went, took American troops without authorization, took the 60 days to please his girlfriend or boyfriend, and started a war somewhere in the world, is that constitutionally permissible under the executive power?
Well,
I'm trying to distinguish between despotic power and executive power. That's the question.
You're talking about a criminal prosecution. Obviously, we have no common criminal law. What statute are you alleging is violated by... What criminal statute is violated by that act?
The question that I'm asking is whether the president, under his constitutional power, leaving aside the statutory aspect, whether the president, as a constitutional matter, could go ahead and send troops to war, and some people get killed, to please his girlfriend or boyfriend, under the constitutional executive power, or is there a limit on it in the Constitution?
I'm not saying there is no limit, but I'm saying if we're talking about force short of war, the president has the power to commit troops to a setting, even if he had an ulterior motive for doing it, and he would not be subject to any criminal charge. He's limited by the Constitution.
I understand. You know. I'm trying to find out that limit. Is it, and excuse me, I have to go back to the point, Professor Turner, because maybe I'm not being precise enough. My question is whether that president, with his authority, under the limits that you're saying there, can start a war or start some kind of action, commit troops, people who potentially get killed, to please his girlfriend or boyfriend under the Constitution.
Well, yeah, you've predicated your question on criminal prosecution. You have to have a criminal statute, you know, an 18 U.S.C. statute, and then the question becomes, does that statute interfere with independent constitutional power of the president? And if Congress were to pass a criminal statute that said the president cannot, for example, as the War Powers Resolution does, one of the things, if you read Section 2C2, it says the president can use force pursuant to a statutory authorization like the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, and also to protect U.S. territory and armed forces against a foreign attack, but it makes no reference to U.S. citizens. Now, that's unconstitutional. I actually debated Jacob Javits on this in December 84 before the American branch of the International Law Association, and to my shock, he agreed with me, and he said we couldn't get the House to agree with putting in civilians. But if Congress made it a crime for the president to use the armed forces to protect American citizens, say, in the high seas, that would violate his constitutional power. As John Marshall told us in Marbury, an act of the legislature repugnant to the Constitution is void. If it's void, it's not one of those laws the president has a duty to see faithfully executed, so the president would win that. And in so many things the president does, if he has an ulterior motive, he's angry, like George W. Bush is angry because Saddam tried to kill his daddy, if that was really the reason he wanted to go into Iraq, he could still go. Of course, he had the approval of Congress to go, but there's an awful lot of silliness out here on that being an illegal war. If you want to know what happened, go to Snopes.com and search Congressional Democrats Iraq or WMD, and you will find that virtually every major Democratic leader announced prior to going to war, and I'm talking about Ted Kennedy, John Kerry, Jay Rockefeller, Hillary Clinton as a senator, the National Security Advisor to the President, Berger, the Secretary of State, all said Saddam has WMD and has to be stopped. Jay Rockefeller, the chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee, said he has a nuclear program and has to be stopped. That's what everybody believed. Joe Biden went on, I think it was Meet the Press or Face the Nation, and said he's got nuclear weapons, we got to stop him. He went back after the war and was confronted by Mr. Russett and said, well, what was going on? And Biden said, well, maybe he didn't have them, but everybody in the world thought he did. And that's the fact. You know, before George Bush came to Washington, Congress passed by overwhelming majority something called the Iraq Liberation Act that said it should be the policy of the United States to support the removal of Saddam Hussein and his replacement by democratic government.
Yes, but it didn't authorize the use of military force.
That it was some right-wing conspiracy You know, it simply is not true. It doesn't hold up to the facts. It may have been a very unfortunate blunder. Certainly the way it was executed was not very good. But the idea that Bush tricked the nation or lied to the nation just doesn't hold up at all when you look at the facts.
Next question, please.
Kind of a basic question about War Powers Act. I lecture to my students at Kent State University on the War Power Act, and when I mentioned that one provision is that Congress must notify the president within 48 hours.
The
president must notify Congress. They laugh, and they think that's, you know, pretty obvious that that should be happening. So I'm wondering what, you know, what was it in particular about the War Powers Act in this context that's significant? Prior to the War Powers Act, you know, was there no obligation of the president to notify Congress or to consult with Congress, gain some kind of approval? Is this something, some small, asset of the War Powers Act to kind of codify the need for this simple notification of Congress about this use of force?
There's a lot to be said on that.
Okay. Oh, it seems like the one useful thing about it.
Yeah, well, when Jefferson in 1801 sent two-thirds of the Navy halfway around the world with instructions to sink and burn ships, he did not formally tell Congress until December 8th. But Congress knew about it because it was written up in the newspapers. But he didn't see an obligation. Now, in all of the controversial wars, it was World War I and World War II were not controversial, but certainly 20th century wars, in Vietnam, in Korea, Truman personally met with the leadership of Congress twice in the week following the June 25th invasion. And then Congress took a 10-day recess for the 4th of July. He then met with the only leader of Congress left in Washington, which was Scott Lucas, the majority leader. And he showed Lucas this AUMF that he had Acheson draft, and Lucas talked him out of it. There was not a problem. There was no problem in Vietnam. If you really I teach a seminar on Vietnam. In fact, I just had a class two nights ago. LBJ didn't want to go to war. He wanted to go down in history as the next FDR with a great society, civil rights, all these things. And he was under pressure from two things, Congress and the American people, to do something in Vietnam. When he finally submitted the Gulf of Tonkin resolution, there were hearings on it. There were witnesses from the executive branch. Congress, by a 99.6% vote, authorized him to use force. And when Fulbright was asked, are we authorizing him to use forces could lead to war? Fulbright replied, that is the way I would interpret it. What did the public think between the Gallup poll in July of 1964 and August? His approval shot up 58%, a 30-point jump, which Gallup attributed to public support for him using force in Vietnam. And it's another one of those myths that we tell everyone, oh, you know, if you're a Democrat, Nixon dragged us into war. If you're Republican, LBJ dragged us into war. They played it by the book. Congress approved it, and Congress funded it by 98% margins for years until the Tet Offensive, one of our biggest successes in the war. We totally destroyed the Viet Cong. But the American press, and I was there. I was in Vietnam in 68. The American press, for the most part, hung out in a few bars at hotels. They didn't want to get shot at. The VC were working the press, you know, one of the top, in fact, the top Vietnamese reporter in Vietnam working for Americans turned out to be a North Vietnamese Army colonel the whole time. There's a book written about him. He retired as a general, Pham Swan An. And they were telling him, oh, no, the Americans are getting their butts kicked everywhere. And that's what the story was in the States. In reality, they suffered many times more casualties. They held Hue briefly. Because we decided not to use artillery and air power because of all the historic properties and so forth. But everywhere else they went, they got their butts kicked. But the American people were told by the press, we got our butts kicked, the communists are winning, that means the president's lying to you, the public turned against the war. And at that point, Congress passed the War Powers Resolution to prevent another Vietnam. To give you one example, Jacob Javits, I loved him. He was brilliant, one of the most finest, except on this issue. In 1966, Wayne Morse introduced an amendment to repeal the Tonkin Resolution. It overwhelmingly was tabled. Javits said at the time, it is a fact, whether we like it or not, that by virtue of having approved the Southeast Asian resolution, we, that meaning the Senate or Congress, are a party to present policy. If, a few months later, when my friend John Norton Moore wrote a massive 200-page legal brief that the ABA House of Delegates approved supporting the war legally, Javits put it in the record and said there can no longer be any doubts about the legality of the war. In 1972, he introduced the War Powers Resolution, quote, to stop future presidents from taking the nation to war without the approval of Congress. It was a lie. It was a fraud. And it saddened me because he was such a wonderful guy. But this, you're exactly right. The key, it's two things. It's partisanship, but it's partisanship driven by public opinion polls. Classic case, right after Vietnam, we had the Mayaguez rescue. Congress had passed a law saying no money could be used to support combat operations in the air, on the ground, off the shores of North Vietnam, South Vietnam, Laos, or Cambodia. Gerry Ford did all three in Cambodia because they had seized an American merchant ship, the SS Mayaguez, with 42 or 43 crewmen. And he sent in air power, Marines to land and rescue the hostages and so forth. What happened? The public thought it was a success. The Foreign Relations Committee passed a unanimous resolution praising the operation. I was working for the committee then, I remember this, as fully consistent with the spirit of the War Powers Resolution. And when Frank Church was asked, well, what about this law you passed that said he can't spend any money for combat operations over Cambodia? We didn't mean to stop something like this. Don't let anyone say we liberals don't want to protect our people. Well, that is why John Locke said you cannot give this business to Congress, because you cannot anticipate all of the things that will happen in diplomacy, negotiations on a foreign battlefield. The death of a prince, the loss of a battle may change the most favorable situation into one against our interest. And those who preside must be left in position to act for the public good. That was the argument. And since the War Powers Resolution, we've had half a dozen lessons that show that when you have Congress trying to micromanage military operations, things get screwed up.
Yeah, let me just add the fill in the blank, very abbreviated, the way I would answer that, which is simply to say that all presidents from the beginning of our republic recognize the inherent scope of executive authority for lots and lots and lots of reasons, to protect American lives, American interests. Eisenhower in particular talked about the interdependence. He said, I really feel the obligation. Now that's particularly telling to me because he's coming at that from seeing how important that is operationally in the field. The other side of that coin, though, is that when President Nixon begins to authorize bombing in Cambodia, what he's really doing is attacking supply lines. He's attacking the safe haven. It's in my view, the early version of, we might talk about this, but it's drone strikes in Yemen. Same type thing. Here's a safe haven, and I see an operational need as commander-in-chief to address that. And that's an operational tactical question. And yet it's one that's very politically laden and politically sensitive. I think as a pragmatic matter, you're right, that 48-hour notice, whatever time period we want to put on it, is superfluous, yeah. as a pragmatic matter.
Yeah, the magic thing is that the report triggers other things.
Right.
I mean, there are hundreds, thousands of statutory reporting requirements that require presidents to do things. The thing is that this one triggers the 60-day clock.
But I would argue Congress doesn't.
We have let some other
Congress
guys.
Doesn't have the power to make him report. That's a different issue. We can talk later.
Next question, please.
John Quigley, Ohio State University. I think the panel has adequately talked about the complexity.
Just adequately.
What?
Just adequately. We haven't done awesome.
Super adequately.
All right. Thank you.
But I'm wondering about some of the, whether there are real need for some limitations, if not precisely the War Powers Act. I mean, something. Professor Turner referred to J. William Fulbright and his statement about the extent of presidential power. Back when the president was concluding base agreements with Spain in the 70s, J. William Fulbright led a campaign against the president
That's
for
right.
failing to go to the Senate to get advice and consent. And with the Gulf of Tonkin resolution, LBJ outright lied to the Congress to get them to pass it. There wasn't any attack on the vessels. I mean, he had been informed by the Navy that the initial report was not accurate, that they were looking at their own bleeps or something on the radar screen. And we've got a whole series of situations that have been like that, and not exactly what Professor Davis was suggesting about pleasing
John,
girlfriends.
Can I cut you off
sure.
just quickly? Because I think we've got about 2 minutes to go. Okay. But I mean, I think you're right. I think there needs to be mechanisms that work for meaningful interaction between the executive and the Congress. I think here I'm probably more of a wet than my friend Bob here. But this is not it. This hasn't worked. There have been various proposals for re-engineering it. None of them have gotten past the starting gate. But I think there's a lot of things going on where we need to have a serious national conversation, and we're not having it. I mean, we are engaging in what I think could reasonably be viewed as acts of armed attacks in the cyber area. Nobody's talking about that. There's no meaningful conversation about it. Unfortunately, we happen to be at a point in time where we can't have a meaningful national conversation about
anything.
You know, about anything. But I think I think you're right. There's a need for something, but this ain't it.
I agree with John, I agree with John, and I would be hard pressed to think of Congress, aside from the partisanship issues we exist right now, but of repeal and replace with what? I think there's a lot of people in Congress who are perfectly happy to sit on this. And not want to move anything on it until they're really convinced there's something extraordinary that they should do. Otherwise, they'll just give another blanket AUMF and then sit back on the War Powers Resolution when they need to sit back on it for political purposes.
We have 1 minute to...
While he's coming up, can I have just 10 seconds just to make a point?
Sure.
LBJ did not lie about Gulf of Tonkin. Bowen Jopp told McNamara the first attack did occur. The second attack did not, but LBJ acted... on the basis of the reports he got. There was no evidence of a lie there. There was a later cover-up by NSA, but there was, in fact, an attack. But more importantly, that's not why we went to war. If you read the resolution, Hanoi has admitted they made a decision May 19, 1959, to open the Ho Chi Minh Trail and liberate the South. We were responding to every bit as much aggression as we were in Korea. It was just covert.
That was some 10 seconds.
Sorry about that.
I've been hearing War Powers Resolution and Act used interchangeably. My understanding was it was passed over Nixon's veto, which would render it an act. Was it an act? Was it a resolution?
It was a joint resolution, which is a statute.
Is it legally significant as to which it is?
No,
it's
a statute. The same mechanism we used to declare war, a joint resolution passed over a veto, was permitted by Article 1 of the Constitution. Every bit as any other statute is legal.
I'd like to... thank our panelists very much.
Good job.
Have you ever seen a breakdown?
Good job, Bob.
Thank you very much, Laurie, and our panelists.
Thank you.
This says that there's a lunch break.